business where you can get by selling a few records and then keep a record deal and continue to come out to LA and sit in swimming pools all day.
In 2006, The Feeling released their debut album, 12 Stops and Home. It spawned five singles, including the top 10 hits Soul, Fill My Little World and Never Be Lonely. They went on to become the most played band on UK radio, picked up a Brit nomination and walked away with an Ivor Novello Award for Songwriters of the Year.
There's a lot of bands now that sound like The Feeling. They've kind of opened the doors, that were the godfathers of that style of music. And now all these bands have come in the slipstream, so it's important that when we come back with a bang.
The boys spent almost 2 years promoting the first album, and just 2 weeks after they returned from the American leg of the tour, the five members, Dan, Richard, Paul, and brothers Kieran and Kevin Jeremiah, went into hiding in the Wiltshire countryside to begin work on the follow-up.
So it's 7 o'clock on, Thursday, I think. I'm editing, just been recording guitar parts, Dan. Look at that mess. Going pretty well, you know, sounds all right. Could be a hit. Maybe.
The first record we made was in the Jeremiah family shed, nobody telling us to be quiet. It was just us. And we wanted the same to happen for this record, but there's no way we were going to go back to the shed because it was stinky. So we ended up in this great big mansion.
This is Bradley House. We've been living in here for a while, making our second album. It's owned by the Duke of Somerset, and he let us use it, which is nice.
We get lawnmowers and sheep and birds singing and all that kind of thing, but when it's blended in with the music, you don't really notice it. And in the moments where you might hear a phone ring or you might hear something else, I think it just adds character. It's the sounds of the house we recorded in. Do anything, you're moving, but you don't do anything. If you want something to sound big, use the smallest amp.
Sometimes someone just comes up with a good line or a little chord sequence or something, and then that can set me off, and then I'll go and write it into a proper song.
It's not like I plan it and kind of map it out very well, and I don't do anything in a specific order. So I might have, oh yeah, that's going to be a good chorus. I'll just keep on piecing it together slowly while I'm sitting there. And then the last thing to get finished off is normally the lyric. I'm still writing the second verse, you know, 5 minutes before I put the vocal down. We started off just recording about four songs a week. By the end of it, we'd recorded about 20 songs. I mean, it's still at the end of the day, there was probably about 15 that we had to really kind of cut down to 12 for the album.
My favourite track on the album is Without You, which is a song that Dan wrote while we were on tour in America. Winter's come and summer's go. Last time round for all we know. Wonder what the time is in London. As they tear this world apart, step by step it breaks my heart. We were in Virginia doing a show, and on the day of the show, it was the Virginia Tech massacre happened. Which is obviously all over the news, but we were very close by to it, and it was certainly affecting the area we were in. 30 dead and one teenage gunman. I wonder what the time is in London without you. It got me because I was there and I really experienced that exact moment that he was inspired by, but it's definitely something that we can all relate to, that when something tragic happens when you're away from home, how much it makes you miss home and miss all the people at home, and question the fact that, you know, what if you don't see those people again, and how awful that would be. It's raining hard in North Virginia.
end of July, the recording process has come to an end, and the record company is keen to hear if their money's been well spent.
We have some people coming to visit us today via helicopter, which is very exciting. They're going to come down and we're going to play them some of the new stuff from the new record and see if they like it.
It's going to be really nice to see sort of reactions on the faces of strangers.
I'm not.
Dan's not looking forward to it.
Our little place.
Oh, you don't invaded.
Coming down here, getting all nosy.
If the record company VIPs don't like what they hear, it'll be a major setback. So, what was the verdict?
So that went rather well, actually. They seemed to like it. And we actually played the songs pretty much right. It's the first time we've played them to anyone other than ourselves, so cheers.
But it's not all work, as the band still have some rock star cliches to live out. How else would you expect the Lords of the Manor to travel?
Break, break, Charlie. Charlie, too. I did it for me. I'm not really particularly materialistic or ostentatious, but I would love one of them. I mean, that's not too much to ask, is it?
I'm going to get one. Apparently, they're quite expensive.
Welcome to California, baby!
The band head off to LA with the recorded tracks to have them fine-tuned by Spike Stent, the king of the mix, who's worked with everyone from Madonna to U2.
Mixing is balancing all the levels so that it sounds as good and exciting and as big as possible. I want you now, I don't
care how, we're both too young to be seen. This is the point at which we put it all together and see how it all turns out really once it's properly mixed. It's the kind of the polishing of it really. You know, bringing out all the colours and all the textures that are in the music and making sure that they're all audible. There's a lot that goes into that. It's a much more complicated thing than anyone would think, which is why we're in LA. Because you can't just do it with anyone, you have to do it with good people. And Spike is brilliant. He's one of the best.
This sounds a bit like a cross between The Who and Donna Summer. It's a strange kind of thing.
You know what I mean?
Want a more dramatic?
Yeah, more dramatic.
When we were mixing, I thought it was over. It wasn't as straightforward as you'd think. With any kind of music that's kind of crossing over genres, it's really hard to get the production right, really hard to get the mix right particularly. Some people wanted the disco side of it, and some people wanted the more rocky side of it. And it's always a bit of a balance, trying to get the best out of both.
It is probably just the effect. I want a more dramatic effect on them, really.
The guitars have gone up, so it's sounding thicker, but it's less spacious. Just in the chorus, it actually was worse in the first chorus for some reason.
Do you want me to put it back as it was?
He's loving this.
That was a challenge, getting that right. Could have gone either way, but it was worth it.
It's not actually normally like this. Normally it just happens.
I haven't had enough time to take a break from the record in order to come back to it and listen to it and be able to judge it, you know. So you just kind of keep working at it, try and make it sound better, try and make it sound better, but it's hard to get a real clear idea of how well it's going.
This one here is what we use for talent. That corrects the mistakes. We tried to get it to go further, but
We broke the knob.
Look, this was my favourite control right here. See that? Makeup. Because if you need a little bit more powder, or mascara, or whatever. Just as you can see, we have makeup.
We've got makeup on full.
I Thought It Was Over was always going to be the first single. Even with the demo I had, it had this sense of energy.
We don't think it would sound like something people would expect from us for a start. So when they get that, buy the second album, put it on for the first time, I think they'll be quite surprised to hear that tune.
We were often told to make our music sound harder, you know, kind of like more edgy. Because, you know, you're for your rock band, you're supposed to rock, you're supposed to be this, you're supposed to be that, you're supposed to fit into that category. And we're not that, you know. I like making kind of pop, aspirational, shiny, joyful pop music, you know. I want to put smiles on people's faces.
After some serious studio stress, the band head down to the beach for a photo session with legendary lensman Henry Diltz.
Hello.
Who was the official photographer at the original hippie music festival, Woodstock, and snapped most of the band's 60s and 70s heroes, including Bob Dylan, Jimi Hendrix, and The Doors.
You might be in the way.
You are in the goddamn way.
Everyone look down there.
Who are those beautiful guys?
They got the feeling.
Now we got some pictures there, even though they kicked us out twice.
Apparently, I'm supposed to beware of so-called friends.
That's right.
You know, do not be so anxious to do favours to others, as there is one who is just waiting to take advantage of your good nature.
There you go.
It's really
Some
scary.
Old guy's going to come up to you up here and try to be friends and pick your wallet out of your pocket, right?
With the album recorded and mixed, the initial stage is complete, but the quality of the music is only part of the final product. The band still have a lot of hard work ahead, and their future remains uncertain.
We have no idea what we're going to be doing for the next year or two. And it could all really be decided in the next couple of weeks.
In May 2007, The Feeling retreated to a country house where they recorded the follow-up to their multi-platinum selling debut album, 12 Stops and Home. After a stop-off in LA to mix the tracks, they're back in the cold of the English countryside for a long and tiring day filming the video to the crucial first single, Thought It Was Over. It's a big budget video shoot, and the day's going to be long and tough. But it's vital that the finished video is strong enough to get them the necessary TV coverage to reconnect the band with their fans. You were there when the wall
came down. Director Paul Miner, who's worked with Muse and Queens of the Stone Age, sent through this idea based on this spooky house thing, which ties in with the way we made the album. That's what we liked about it.
They kind of attract these strange cosmic lights that come down and sort of investigate the space in which they're recording. I thought it was over, but it's not.
I thought it was over, but it's not. I'm gonna do like my little part of the video where I leave the band and I just kind of walk off around the house and trying to figure out where these weird lights are coming from and looking for aliens. I've been visited by aliens, which is basically a big lighting rig, which is sitting outside the window there.
About 25, 27 lights, something like that, on a crane that's being lowered and moved around the performance. So it takes a little bit of work to get that around, but it's been pretty good.
Well, they're supposed to be flashing back at me, but unfortunately it doesn't work. But they will. I think they're just having trouble with the controller for the lights, so they're trying to get it to, you know, undulate. But they're not. Anyway,
playback. Another
year and the job was done. They put in a lot of hard work on this, which is awesome, and everybody's been game for it. And it's been a long day to go through it.
It's 1 a.m., and we've just been told by our director, Paul, that this is a wrap. We are finished.
It's now only 3 weeks till the album's release, and the record company are pulling out all the stops to make sure everyone knows about it. The pressure is mounting for the band, who are busy on the all-important promo trail.
Promo, as they call it, in record company lingo, is something you have to do if you're not very, very, very well known. You do interviews for magazines and papers. You get your photograph taken. It's almost like a necessary evil sometimes, but some of it's fun.
We are doing a cover shoot today with Dan for the March issue. The idea is to do a slightly sort of romantic, nostalgic feel to it, like a bit like kind of 1920s, 30s Hollywood vibe.
I was actually dreading doing the promo and the
shoots and all the stuff, I was really dreading it. But now that I'm getting into it, I'm like dreading it less. I'm like, okay, it's fair enough, it's my job. And actually starting to enjoy it again. I go from looking like I've had a full frontal lobotomy, like that, to looking kind of worried and startled, and I can't seem to quite get the nice relaxed, moody in-between look. And the only other look I have is the eyebrow, and that goes up. And I have very little control over it, but it just goes like that.
After a successful photo shoot, Dan has time to reflect on how the album might be received by the record-buying public.
If I put the album out that I want to put out and nobody wants to buy it and people don't really buy into it for the right reasons, then it's like, fair enough. You've got to kind of live and die by your decisions and by the choices you make, and when we made the album we knew that we were going to make the album that we wanted to make. Because that way at least we did that. If the album doesn't do well, I mean, if you to try and compromise for the sake of record sales in any way what you were making musically and then it didn't do well, you'd be kicking yourself.
Hello?
With such a hectic schedule and constant touring, it's hard for the band to experience normality. On one of Dan's rare days off, he heads down to the local market with boyfriend Ryan. It's a perfect opportunity to think about how success has changed him.
Whenever I'm not in London, I miss it loads. So that's all I can think of really when I think about London is how much it's my home. And I love it because of this, you know, because the markets and all the stuff going on. I think when you're born and raised in a place and it's as exciting as London, you never want to leave it, really. I love it here.
Thank you.
Love saves. People where I live here in East London are really cool. They don't really come up to you and scream at you that much. That happens more when I'm at my mum's place up in the suburbs. It's a bit more like more of a deal.
He's gorgeous. Isn't he beautiful?
Occasionally people do come up and say, I like your record and when's the next record out and stuff like that. And that's quite nice. But normally it's much cooler than that here in London. I mean, even if the band becomes more successful and more well known, I don't think it's going to affect my way of life that much.
Is there a cheese and mushroom and spinach one?
I really don't see myself as a pop star. I see myself as a musician. But I always did see myself as a musician, just that I was a musician who wasn't getting paid.
The band have spent the past few weeks notching up countless press, radio and TV interviews. But today, they're doing a live session on Joe Wiley's hugely influential radio show.
Today, we're here at Maida Vale Studios, the BBC, Radio 1. We're doing Joe Wiley's Live Lounge. But Joe Wiley's actually in central London. We all just talk on headphones and it's not how you picture it, really. I remember listening to this kind of show and you think everyone's just sitting in a room together.
It's like live on the radio. It's not pre-recorded like a lot of them are. There's a little bit more pressure. And I try and be, kind of like positive about it and confident about it. I'm not really that confident the person. I always kind of think that something's definitely going to go wrong.
It's very important. Radio 1 is pretty vital, actually.
A lot of the listeners don't know who they are. They haven't been to see a band live. They've maybe heard like one record or on radio but don't know anything about them. And I guess the Live Lounge gives an audience a sort of a different understanding of maybe what they thought the band was. I mean, it's really important. Really important.
You have 4 minutes, gentlemen.
I'll be relieved when it's over. And I'll probably enjoy it while I'm doing it.
Radio 1's Live Lounge.
We should have there. Feeling very warm and toasty, no doubt, in the Maida Vale Studios. The Feeling. Hello.
Hello there. Hi.
So you all right?
Yeah, very good, thanks.
Very good. What are we wearing today?
I don't know. I've got some bright canary yellow socks on today. But I knew I was going to be on the radio, so I didn't make that much effort. I do apologise.
Oh, God. Are we not taking photographs of you down there?
Well,
or
there's
have
loads
you
of cameras
refused?
In the, yeah. There's loads of cameras in the room with us as well. So,
it's not just radio anymore.
Oh,
do you know what?
Good.
Weight is lifted off. I've been moody for the last 2 days.
Just
yesterday and today, because it's such a stressful one, this one.
You don't realise the pressure of live radio. When that red light up there is on, you know that you're live and whatever you say and do is going out to the nation and there's nothing that can change it.
We've got 2 weeks to go now until the album comes out, until it's released properly. And yeah, pressure is mounting a little bit. It feels a bit weird.
It's like living in a limbo where, you know, basically everything's kind of out there. We've done these TVs, we've done this promotion, and that seems to have gone well. But until the public react to it, we have no idea what we're going to be doing for the next year or two. And it could all really be decided in the next couple of weeks.
The single is finally out, and Dan's at home waiting for the midweek chart position.
The midweek chart is the point at which you get... It's the first point. It's for very impatient people, because it's the first point at which you get a sense of how well your single's going to do. Because the figures, sales figures from all the shops kind of get accumulated, and then they get published. I'd rather not know. I wish that it wasn't about chart position. I wish it was less important, because it puts an unnecessary stress on people like me with a nervous disposition.
Hello? Oh, marvellous. That's the highest one we've done yet. Ooh, okay, good. Oh, well. All right, mate. Cheers. I know, yeah. All right, cheers, mate, bye. Six. Which is good.
Well, last time our single went seven. No, the single after that, we went eight, and the album went at number two. So surely, if it's number six, that means the album has to go in at number one. Obviously.
The culmination of 9 months' work from a team of people spanning the Atlantic, The Feeling's follow-up album, Join With Us, is finally ready to hit the shelves. An initial sign suggests the band have another hit on their hands. It all seems to be going to plan, but is frontman Dan happy with the result?
When I think about things like chart position and sales and all of that stuff, reviews and competitions and awards, I find all of this stuff really stressful, because I'm still that kid who just wants to sit and play music and hope people like it.